Well, I'm back here at Westwood Lakes near Boston in Lincolnshire, and today I've come onto Skylark Lake, which is a little bit more like the usual fishing that I do. Carp, some decent sized barbel with an odd F1. It's not really like Falcon Lake or the other lakes on site here where there's a massive head of those smaller F1s and it's a numbers game. I actually drew along here in one of the Darwa festivals and caught £147 of mainly carp and a few barbel. And today I want to go through what I look for and how I actually caught those fish. Here at Westwood you haven't got an awful lot of water to play with. It's about 13.5 metres wide here today. And I do expect to catch a few fish across. And the reason for this, peg 2 on Skylark is one of the few pegs you can get into a good depth of water across, about 14 inches, which is absolutely perfect for catching the carp and that. However, it is quite windy. There's quite a strong wind left to right, which is going to make fishing pellets across quite hard. One thing we've spoke about in the e-magazine is to keep your eyes and ears open as far as what's working. And I was here a few weeks ago and pellets across with potting in micro pellets is definitely the way for the carp. The barbel and the carp in the edge, it's more casts and maggots. So it is completely different to Falcon Lake and, like I say, the other lakes on site. There's a few pegs along this strait where you can't actually get in close because the dugals are hanging over. And this peg too is a little bit of an exception. You've got a little bit of a mud bank which enables you to get in the correct depth of water. And if we can hold the pole today, I do expect to hook a few carp over there on expander pellets. Again, down the edge, slightly different here on Skylark. You do catch a few carp on the end pegs fishing right in the margins, but today I'm going to target them just down the shelf and hopefully catch some decent barbel and maybe an odd carp as well. This on casters and maggots, it's about 1.25 metres off the bank, just at the bottom of the shelf. And to be fair, it's not an area that I would normally target on a lot of venues I go, but for some reason here on Skylark, the middle pegs, it really does seem to produce not just barbel but carp and also some decent F1s and skimmers. It really is a mixed fishery, this Skylark Lake. It's one of my favourite lakes on site. I spoke about different depths of water and it is something that you have to look for. When we were here before on Falcon Lake, we spoke about 20 inches, 18 inches, which is perfect for the F1s. It's a little bit too deep for these carp and you do want to be getting in around 14, 15 inches. And that's one of the reasons I've sat here on peg 2 today, because I know it's one of the few pegs where you can get across and get in that depth of water. Yes, we might be hampered by the wind a little bit, but I'm sure if we find it difficult across, the edge should come to our rescue. And it's also a very good exercise to fish this line 1.25 metres off the bank, just in slightly deeper water, because on a lot of commercials it's a line that's totally neglected. A lot of the regulars and a lot of the locals, when you walk along here, they're fishing that line, and the fish on this lake are used to feeding there and used to bait being there. And it's a line that I've targeted in the past on this lake to great effect. The barbel seem to be a little bit shoaled up. You either catch a lot of them or you don't catch any. Last time I was along this bit, I caught 5 or 6 decent ones, up to about £3.5, along with some carp in the margin. And the sort of way I want to approach it today is to start across, cupping in micros with the pot on the pole. Again, very accurate, looking at plumbing up very accurately in that depth of water. Again, the pot very close to the end of the pole. Everything's going to be fed through the pot nice and accurately. And I'm going to lift and drop and just position that expander right over the top of the bait. Like I say, I've got a nice bit of mud bank, no dugals to hamper me at all. It's just the wind that could play a little bit of a part in hampering us with the long pole. As far as the margin's concerned, I'm going to kick off the session with half a pot of casters and a few dead maggots, and I'm going to loose feed. The only twist is, when I do fish there, I'm going to use a slightly bigger cad pot full of casters and position those right on top of my float, as well as loose feeding as well. So I think it's now time to have a look at the rigs that I've put up for today's session. I'm going to start with a rig for a cross. Again, it's a 0.4 float, 018 mainline. It's stepped up a little bit on this lake because the fish are notoriously that little bit bigger. 015 hook length and a size 16 gamma power. Again, just a nice bulk of shot, 5 number 8s and a number 11 style, just to give it that dotted down. What I want to be able to do is to fish across nice and dotted and just strike when I get a real fast movement. Again, that's set the body and the bristle over depth. Now the length of line between the tip and the elastic obviously is slightly longer. Normally I'd like to fish slightly shorter than that, about 8 inches. With the wind today, I've just left it a little bit longer, around 12 or 13 inches. Again, slightly different to when we fished on Falcon, white hydroelastic. Again, coupled with the fact the fish are just that little bit bigger, a little bit more powerful, I want to fish a slightly stronger elastic. And also the same kinder pot. Again, you've seen that I've cut the holes in it. Again, I explained before why this is, so you can fill it full of micros. Just dunk it in the water and the water gets in around and the micros just fall out. 100% accurate. Also, it's positioned again 5 to 10 mil from the tip. Again, very, very accurate fishing. That's in about 15 inches of water, which is absolutely perfect. Again, same float for down the edge. It's about 2, 2.25 foot of water there. That's at the bottom of the shelf, just as it flattens off a little bit, just before it drops off into the real deep water. Again, white hydro, 018 mainline, 015 hook length, and a size 16 gamma power. The rigs are very similar, all very simple, just a bulk of shot. It's more about the feeding and where you're actually going to fish in your peg. You'll see with this one, I've got a bigger cad pot that can be full of casters, maybe even some dead maggots if a few barbels start to show. Again, this is situated a little bit further over depth, about 2 inches. Again, I'm going to be fishing either 3 dead red maggots or double caster on this. And as we know, with casters and maggots, just a little bit more line on the bottom is definitely the way to go. So like I say, they're the rigs that I'm going to use. I've put up a duplicate as well, just in case of any breakages, because the barbel and that do tend to go. Again, just touching on the setup before we start fishing. I'm going to be fishing in the edge to my right. So you can see I've set up slightly to the left-hand side. I've pinned my nets down again, made sure they're all in deep water, but again, they're tied down. There's nothing worse than starting to catch a few fish in the margins and then your nets start to swim round or they move in the wind and the tow, and then that's your day totally wrecked. So always make sure you get nice and comfy. When you decide what side you're going to fish, always sit slightly away from it. The pegs here at Westwood are very generous. You've got about 12 or 13 metres, but if you can just give yourself a couple of extra foot, it could make all the difference. I now want to go through the bait I've bought for today's session. Again, I've bought some maggots and some casters. I've got a couple of pints of dead reds there. Again, for the hook and to feed, especially if a few barbels start to appear. Real nice fresh maggots. Just put in the freezer overnight and then thawed out. Again, the casters, I bought 4 pints of casters. When you catch fish on this line, especially the barbel, they really can respond to quite heavy baiting, especially towards the end of the session. So an odd big handful of casters, coupled with a decent sized cab pot full of casters, should hopefully keep them in the peg and keep them there feeding. As far as a cross is concerned, the micro pellets I'm going to feed, again, have been soaked. These have been soaked for about an hour now. Again, totally submerged in water, about 1/2 inch of water on top and then just left. They do take a good hour and a half to get perfect, but you can see there now, they're nice and spongy, can just be thumbed into that cad pot and deposited perfectly and accurately in the right part of the peg. And again, for the hook, I've got some Ringers expander pellets. Again, 4 mils. They're nice and rubbery. You want a real rubbery pellet when you're fishing across, especially at lengths like this, so that they don't just fall off. There's nothing worse than getting all the way across, lifting your rig up and your pellets come off. So always have a look for a nice rubbery one. Nice 4 mil pellet. And again, this fished in conjunction with fed micro pellets should catch us a few carp in this peg. Well, that's the bait. I've shown you the rigs. Now I'm going to get on and try and catch a few fish. Thank you. Well, I started the session across. We've been fishing probably well over an hour now. And it's been quite good, although the wind's been hampering me a little bit. Probably caught 8 or 9 carp, a crucian, and 3 or 4 F1s. So it really has gone well. There's a nice little flat, shallow plateau right against the bank over there. And they really do seem to feed quite well in that depth of water. And like I said earlier, the one advantage you have got here on peg 2 is the fact that you can get across and you can get into that shallower water, which obviously cuts down a lot on line bites and foul hooking the fish. Definitely seems to be where they want to be, but you get an odd one bow wave off that you spook. One then just to the right just bow waved off, but in that shallow water, fish that have been fished for a lot, you're going to get that quite a bit. They're quite spooky. But I'm still feeding in the edge, 30-40 casters at a time. I've not seen any movement down the edge, but I'm just looking at catching what I can across, fishing nice and accurate, feeding nice and accurate, and just building up that, I call it an edge line, but it's a good meter out from the edge. Just building that up. Should catch some carp there, but there's a good chance if there's some barbel around of catching on that line as well. If you're going to catch a number of barbel, that's where they'll be. They seem to like patrolling that ledge. They definitely like casters and maggots, so those two put together, there's a chance if there's some barbel in the area. The only thing is that those barbel, they're a little bit notorious for being in a few pegs and not in every peg. But, like I say, I've caught them here before. Getting little indications over there all the time. I've had a couple of little skimmers as well, but it's probably a good time to talk about being patient over there. A lot of people think it's crash, bang, wallop, get one every chuck as soon as your float cocks, and it's not. Sometimes you'll wait 4, 5, 6, 7 minutes without an indication, and then it'll fly under and you'll catch a carp. So it's a case of getting nice and comfortable. You can see the marker that I've put on my pole with the tape. Exactly where I've plumbed up, exactly where I'm fishing and feeding, more importantly. There's still some fish over there. I'm getting odd little indications, but not many bites. What I'm going to do, I'm not going to give it too long without actually hooking a fish. I'll give it 7 or 8 minutes without hooking a fish, then come in and feed again. Just because I haven't caught one, I don't want to let my feeding pattern completely go. And also, when I come in, it's easy for me to feed in the edge as well. As far as looking for signs in the edge is concerned, because it's that little bit deeper, you're not really going to see any swells or indications. It's a case of just building it up. When you come in on this rig, like I say, 30 or 40 casters, you're not really going to see many indications, which forces you into having to have a look to see if the fish are there. But again, you'll know pretty soon if there's fish in the area because you'll get indications and bites. I've gone down the edge and it really is solid down there on that line that we've fed with maggots and casters. I've had a couple of carp and about 7 or 8 proper barbel up to 4 pound. It really is absolutely solid. It just goes to show that for those 2 and a bit hours when we're fishing across, just keep the bait going in on your other lines and you can really reap the benefit. And it also, it just goes to show that just because the venues you fish all the time, you don't necessarily target a specific area in your peg. When you come somewhere like Westwood, different lines, different approaches can work. For instance, if I was fishing at Gold Valley, this line, you know, I probably would never ever feed this line, but here at Westwood it can be a match winning line. As you can see now, these barbel, real powerful fish for their size, but fantastic fish, perfect condition, strong, and like I say, if you can target them and you can get them in your peg, you can have an absolute fantastic day, and if it's a match, a fantastic weight. All I'm doing is kinder potting a big cad pot, half filling it with dead maggots and then topping it up with casters. Reason I'm not throwing it now is because I'm trying to pop some bait in and put my float, and more importantly my hook bait, right on top of it. I did foul hook a couple of fish when I first went down there, but I think that's because I was throwing bait in, and since I've just started potting it, virtually everyone's hooked properly. They're real strong fish, those barbel, and I'm on white hydro, I've stepped up to 015. They really are powerful fish for their size. It's almost, the carp that we caught across were almost slightly bigger, some of them, and not quite as powerful, but odd little liners, but when you get a bite, it's just walloped straight under. Fishing those 2 inches over depth, so a little bit more than we would do, say, on pellets. Always like to fish a tiny bit more than I would do, especially when you're fishing three red maggots on the hook. There we go, it's absolutely solid down the edge now, and we've got another proper barbel on here. Absolutely fantastic fishing. Not many still waters anywhere where you can go and catch quality fish of this size. Absolutely lifting. See, look at that for a barbel. Probably a good 5.5 pound. Absolutely fantastic. Caught a couple of carp down there, and then the barbel have really moved in force. And like I say, it really is a case of just hooking one every cast now. One little trick with barbel that is a fantastic little thing to know, that quite often you can foul hook a few, and one of the best ways around it is to hold a tight line so that they actually hook themselves. They're very ferocious feeders, and what you can actually do by holding a tight line, you just float, just dips and goes under, dips and goes under, and when it goes, the elastic comes out, and every single one then's hooked properly in the mouth. It's a fantastic way of fishing if you do get in problems with foul hooking them. There's an absolute million fish down there now. The float's up and down all over the place. And I think if I was striking at every single bite or every single time the float went under, I'd probably foul hook quite a few. Really is unbelievable. I can't believe how many barbel are there. Some carp there at the start, and we probably caught a dozen carp fishing across. And now it's just absolutely solid with these barbel. Another one there. Absolutely gorgeous fish. Not a mark on them. The only problem is they do fight a lot harder than the carp. But what a fish to catch. Just touching a bit more on the tight line, because I've only got about 8 or 9 inches of line, all I'm doing is just holding my pole tip above the float at a slight angle, and what happens is any line bites and that, the float just goes under and comes back up. It's only something I do for barbel, I don't do it for carp, because the barbel feed really aggressively, and when you actually get a proper bite off of one, it'll pull the elastic straight out. If you're not careful with barbel, because they've got massive fins, you can end up foul hooking a few by striking at all the bites. So if you ever get in the situation, or come to somewhere like Westwood and you're lucky enough to get on these barbel and you do have problems with foul hooking them, then definitely try just keeping a tight line from float to tip, and then all of a sudden your elastic will be out, and it really is a fantastic little trick if you do get in problems. When I was here in the match, I didn't keep a tight line at all. I struck at every bite, but there's a lot less fish in my peg. But today, like I say, it's just absolutely solid on that line. I'm getting a lot of indications in that, and just by keeping a tight line, they're just pulling the elastic out when they do take it properly. I've stuck with the three dead red maggots for hook bait. It's the number one bait for barbel, really. They just see it and I just think that they absolutely love it. I'm feeding half a pot full of dead maggots, half of dead red maggots, and half a pot full of casters. And this has just kept fish coming all the time. I did foul hook a couple when I first went down there, but I think that was because I was still throwing bait in rather than just potting it. And it really has, you know, been a fantastic day's fishing, because like I said, when I caught that last barbel, there's not many places you can go and catch that many quality barbel in a day. There we go, we've reached the end of the session and it's been an absolutely fantastic day. Caught well across, probably a dozen or 14 half decent carp, along with some decent F1s and a couple of skimmers. I did lose a couple of foul hookers across, but that's what's going to happen. But all in all, the bite to actual fish ratio was pretty good. I didn't get in a mess, fishing really accurately right across in the shallowest water. It's very important to have markers, like on your pole, like I did with the masking tape. It's all very, very important. Have the part right on the end of the pole, plumb up very accurately. I know I repeat myself a lot, but I can't put enough stress on how important accuracy is, especially when you're fishing across. Like I say, we managed to pick quite a few fish off. Had a little look down the edge after about 2 and a bit hours, and it was absolutely solid. I caught some carp there, but mainly barbel. I would have thought we've had in excess of 20 barbel down there, when you think most of them are £3 plus, and we've had them up to about £5.5. It's been absolutely fantastic. One little tip, I know we touched on it when we were actually fishing, but if you do get on a nest of barbel and you're lucky enough to come to a place like this and be on those barbel, definitely holding a tight line can work, because when you actually get a bite, they just pull the elastic out. Maybe not so good for carp, you need to be hitting the bites there. Towards the end I did catch a couple more carp, and again the bite just went straight under and I struck. Because of the speed of the bite, you could tell that it was definitely going to be in the mouth. So that's another little tip there. Again, accuracy in the edge. Just kinder potting or big kinder potting, maggots and casters work absolutely brilliant. Three red maggots on the hook. I did step up to an 0.15 hook length because I did get broke by a barbel and I did lose one round my net. But again, for the size of the fish, they're very, very powerful indeed, and they do take a bit of taming. So make sure, if you do come to a place like this, gear up for it. So all in all, again, it's about accuracy, plumbing up across, trying to find the shallowest bit. The only other thing I want to touch on when fishing across, and I think it's vitally important, is picking the right place in your peg. A lot of venues like Westwood, you've got dougals, you've got rushes. Not only do you want to find the shallowest bit, but you always want to find the most angler friendly bit. And by this I mean no branches, twigs, any dougals hanging over. Try and pick a place that's quite bare, where you're not going to get in problems with your rig being tangled in the bushes or in the pampas grass. Also, if it's windy, when you strike and you've got anything hanging over above, your rig can be blown into it and you can get in all sorts of trouble. So try and be clever with where you're fishing your peg and make it easy for yourself. So there's a few good tips. It's been a fantastic day again here at Westwoods. I've never had a day catching barbel like that ever anywhere, and I've fished quite a lot of places now. So like I say, it's been fantastic. I hope some of what I've told you could stand you in good stead if you come here to Westwood or to any other commercial fisheries. I think we'll have a look at what we've managed to catch now. Well, there you go, there's a few of the barbel that we've caught. A few too many really to put in a landing net, so I've managed to put a fair few back. They're absolutely fantastic fish. Fit as anything and so strong. When you get on a nest of them, you definitely need to fish heavy. Feed very accurate still. And if you do get problems foul hooking them, remember just to keep that tight line. What a fantastic day. And there's a few of the carp that we caught across early on.